So, we see on the middle of the night a starry sky above the jungle. And in that starry sky, there is a shooting star. Although, if you squint your eyes, you realize that that's no shooting star. That's a vessel flying towards the jungle at incredible speed. The squinted eyes kind of relax a little bit as the elvish features turn into a grin. And the voice says, Good work. Now it's our turn. And the elvish grin starts to spread scales across its face as a figure turns around and enters into the mountain. Meanwhile, on the jungle floor, we rejoin our heroes. It is night. You hear the chirps and the sounds of the jungle moving around you. But it is dark, and the ship is above you. And Rick, you have two bodies recovering unconscious beside you, but the party is on the jungle floor. And Patrick has just come back and said, River, jungle, big lizard. What would you like to do?
Cry. Could we say, before we came and crashed, like I
Yeah.
know what, like the last thing I'd spoken to the captain, we're about an hour away.
Hmm.
Do we have any context of roughly how, like, as in, could we see the city from the from where we were before we crashed?
I think on the way down, you did notice a bunch of lights off to the east of you. Whether that was the main city or not is hard to say. It's one of those things where if you've ever flown over, you know, some rural areas at night, it is pitch black and then you just see the little dots of light where the cities are. But as the ship descended into the jungle, I think you would have lost direction of which way it was
Yeah,
facing.
of course.
but it was still a fair way away.
I think the question becomes, do we wait here for a while? Maybe hope that these two wake up. See if they maybe know if anyone else was expecting us and might come looking for us, or do we push on through the night into the jungle, hauling their unconscious bodies?
I don't like to look up at the wreck above us.
Yep, it kind of like creaks in the trees, like a plank of
Don't
wood
like
duk,
being.
duk, 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 falls down.
I don't like being too close to this.
Not exactly fond of the idea of walking through a unknown woods with unknown creatures already kind of slightly hurt as he clicks his back. I think we should definitely should maybe take it easy, but maybe start thinking of an idea of, I don't know, following the river, see if there's a town alongside it.
Well, I believe the river leads directly to the town, so
Or
maybe
to,
we.
according to Patrick, maybe.
That's only if it's the same river we think it is.
This is true.
Oh, we can't be too far off.
Why don't
Well,
we
maybe a little,
rest
but.
for a small time, maybe make some food, and then make a move and try and find this river?
Yes, we can. Could we hear the river, DM? Was that something we can hear
I
from
think
our current
Vargear got a
position?
pretty high roll in his survival and he could hear it in the distance. Or at least the sound of moving water. And then Patrick confirmed that he could
Same river.
see a river.
I could always throw him up and we can sort of just follow him from behind.
Maybe it might even be better if we use Patrick to just scout what's around us so nothing can at least sneak up on us, and I think I know a pretty good direction of where the river might be.
Okay.
Alright, so we stay quiet and hide for an hour or so, and then see if we can make some progress in the dark.
I think so.
Get a fire going and heal up. Hopefully see if these two wake up.
Maybe let's keep the fire as embers. We don't exactly want to... Well, something attacked us. And just can't be too careful, right?
How far away from the ship are we planning on moving? That's a pretty obvious signal that this is where we were. I imagine that there's a pretty big gash in the trees from above. I'll start looking for some firewood.
Sure, there's some ship debris around you, which would be good, but you do know, like, looking at the trees, they aren't forest trees, they are quite, you know, thick wood, jungle trees, like, even the bark is, like, wrapping around itself, yeah.
Twisting and vines.
Yeah.
And
roots growing and stuff.
And now, even taking a breath and stuff, you notice that the undergrowth underneath you, it's very leafy, like a lot of the leaves have fallen down. It doesn't feel like solid ground, like it's only a couple of inches until there is solid ground, but it is very soft and lots of foliage.
Very kiwi bush.
Yes, yeah.
Would this be like difficult terrain?
Not at the moment.
Okay.
At the moment.
But on that thought, if you had to move at speed, you probably would more want to know what was underneath your feet rather than sprinting through this, because if there was a root or something, you might not see it straight away.
Can I, while Park's collecting wood, can I just take like a kind of like a little bit of a perimeter? And I would just like to like look out and see if I can find any like fresh dung or like tracks, like anything that kind of questions that things might be kind of continuously coming back through here, like it's
sure
hunting and then going to its nest or something.
Yeah, you can give me a survival check.
Sure. 13 plus 3, 16.
16. You kind of start circling the group, getting a wider perimeter each time you go around. As you kind of look through the foliage and stuff, excuse me,
bless you.
You do find quite a bit of wildlife. As you move some, you see little critters skitter off. As you put your hand up against the tree, you see it kind of almost shift in shape, maybe because of something moving up in the top of it or something that's scattered down the other side. You're not quite sure because you're still adjusting to the darkness here, and the further away from the group you get, the less light there is, because I think Ghost casted some form of light.
Yeah, right.
But no dung or anything like that, no prints, but then as you look behind you, you see that the leaves kind of have just naturally pillowed back, and you haven't really left a trail either.
Ah, interesting. Okay. Yeah, cool. Okay. I think as well, like, seeing it's this dark, I'm going to kind of tap in a bit into more of my blind sight when I'm doing these, like, if we do some watches and stuff like that, just so then it's more, like, aware of, like, vibration rather than sight.
As soon as you kind of take that moment to, like, give up your eyesight and just feel what's around you, your senses almost overload a little bit. It seems that there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of energy in this jungle. Kind of almost kind of feel like you've walked outside after being inside for a long time, and your eyes have just, they need to adjust. Your blind sight kind of is like, well, there's a lot going on here, whether it's the trees moving or the leaves blowing or the vines growing or the insects scuttering, it's a lot.
Yeah, it's so this is like a super active forest, like yeah, it's not like, yeah, okay. Then I'll come back to the group.
Hey,
We might need to stick close by. It seems like a... Not even I can leave tracks, even if I tried. The forest seems to kind of cover it up itself. Just maybe keep that in mind.
Okay. I'm getting a bit of food going.
Sure. Yeah, I was gonna say, hearing like skittering and stuff around, and just knowing jungle's a great place for protein snacks. I'm gonna summon Patrick back out as a spider and almost use him, put him down like into some bushes and get him to sort of furrow through and find some little holes where some bugs and stuff are resting, and I'll see if I can get some tasty bugs and start adding those to the food.
Sure. Give me a survival or nature check. You can go with advantage.
Oh, I haven't even got two d20s.
I just saw the name of the GIF and I was like, yeah.
I know exactly.
That'll be we'll go nature. That'll be a 25.
Oh, easily. Patrick scurries down into the ground, and you kind of lose him for a second before you get like the ping in your head that he hasn't even gone 3 feet from you, and you kind of clear the leaves, and you see that there's like a bunch of little tiny warrens, and there are some slugs and grubs in there. Which, yeah, the varying of colours, but you grab a couple and throw them into the mix.
Put them in. Here, put some spices on these. Oh my goodness, you're going to blow your mind.
Sure. I'm not going to eat any.
Fair enough.
I'll put some salt on them, I guess.
Vage will definitely be like, ah, nice, yum.
As Vage and Hera kind of start gulping down these grubs.
Mom has none of these.
I am going to be using special food as a part of my chef thing. So if you, over the short rest, eat one of these foods and use at least one hit dice to regain hit points, you get an extra d8.
Yeah, it's Molokov still, he like comes over and he's like, sees you cooking, he's like, well, you have to... and just like shakes his head.
Yeah. I will not partake really... either.
He's not, I'm gonna just use my normal hit.
Yeah, yeah, I'll pass enough. You some real food.
So yes, at this time here, we can still hit on Molokov Ghost as well. This will be a short rest, if we're just kind of...
Yeah, sorry, that won't happen till the end.
But yeah, if you're just kind of doing a quick stop at the moment. I'm assuming you just moved a little bit away from the ship. But Ghost, what are you up to? If it seems that everyone else is taking the time to kind of just take a moment to stop.
Yeah. I will, as I was going through and checking the bodies and snooping around Shapiro a little bit, the last thing I will do off the end of that will be just to check his hands, to see if there's anything, see if I can feel anything that I can't see across his fingers.
Okay, so he does have gloves on.
I'll remove a glove.
Okay. Same with Onus as well. I think you remember you saw little bulges and stuff under the gloves, but they both wear gloves, kind of, not heavy gloves, but kind of like the noble, you know, keep your hands clean. And actually, I did actually make up Shapiro and Onus the other day, so I'll show them.
Reese, do you mind if we just keep the Onus and bulges and talking to Michael about it, like out of the same context?
No, you can grow up.
I don't want to.
So we've got Onus and Shapiro.
My keyboard's
just a rough idea, as much as we can do in Hero Forge.
Is anyone, like, particularly hurt as well? Like, hurt beyond hit dice getting them up to full? Because I've got some... I hate to say spell slots, considering what we might have ahead of us, but...
I am, but I do have, like, full lay on hands, and I've got two health potions, so if I need the health desperately, I can get it. Unless you can do it for free somehow.
No, I can't do it for free, but I... kind of, like, I don't use many of my spells.
Seems really. Like Puck is full as well.
Yeah,
I'm good. I can short rest up to getting some things.
Wait, have we rolled hit dice?
We haven't rolled hit dice yet.
Not yet. Well, anyone who eats the food will get an extra DM.
Gotcha, yeah.
Ghost, as you, who are you checking? Shapiro.
Shapiro.
You remove one of the gloves and there's one or two ornate rings just like this. Doesn't seem to have any gems on it. It just seems to be made of silver. Yeah, one maybe made of bronze or something, but nothing special. And you kind of move it around, and you know, there's nothing catching on the inside, which is probably what I assume you were looking for. There's no pin or anything like that.
Oh yeah, cool. Yeah, not only, I guess, yeah, that's a good point. I would look at this to see if it is possibly the same as the Bands of Loyalty, assuming it's not the however, I am looking in particular for a ring that can be invisible.
Ah, yes. You move your hand over the whole hand and there is no invisible ring or jewelry attached.
That's
to either
cool.
hand. You can safely assume, for now, that he does not have the ring from the tomb on his possession or on his person.
Wonderful. I'll then spend the next sort of 10 minutes or so just like hoisting the two of them up and like drag them over to a tree and like propping them up a little bit.
Yep.
Knowing that we've kind of done the best that we can for them for now. And then wander over to the campfire where there's a pot of something.
Yeah, it looks quite interesting.
Bubbling away. Without even thinking about it for a second, we'll like grab himself some in a little camping mug and start eating away. Is it any good?
Look, it's an acquired taste. You can definitely taste that it has some sort of sustenance to it, but it is a mix of sour and salty from Puck's trying to season it. Hera's put something into it as well, and it's all good flavors that shouldn't go together.
Yeah, gotcha. Or if it works.
I'll take it.
Beat stink beetles, that's for sure.
Maybe next time.
Okay. I think Molokov, you're the only one that didn't have anything specific right through this short rest.
No, probably just tending to my own wounds and checking up on everyone, making sure
okay
that we're okay, but nothing in particular.
So after about an hour or so of just trying to get your senses back to you, can everyone roll me a perception check, please?
Yeah, I'm glad I got 23,
nice.
13. My keybinds aren't working. What's going on?
I'm glad I got this out of the way early. Natural one.
Natural one. Very nice. Everyone's kind of enjoying, everyone's enjoying their kind of snacks, if you want to call them that. Puck, you have made up some more tasteful food that you can share with Molokov and yourself. But you do feel a bit of a vibration in the ground. and you notice that the buzz, the slight noise floor of the jungle has dipped away.
Is that where you're leaving it to me?
You're hearing some footsteps.
Yeah. Hera, you said big lizard. Hide. Everyone hide. Find a tree to hide under. I'm going to kick over the fire, like, just quickly.
Yep.
Yeah, and just try and find, like, if there's, like, a fallen tree or, you know, I want to find a place to hide. And if I can help others, I will help others hide.
So what you see, I'll give you a bit of a representation.
No, don't put X's on them.
so that's to show that they are unconscious.
Yeah. What is going on?
Oh, what?
So as you...
Our hair is still big.
That's correct.
Oh.
Fuck.
Boom. You all start to hear these footsteps, and they're getting a little bit louder, and you see the trees shake on each one. They are quite, there's a little bit of time in between them. It's like boom, boom, like, you know, it's one, two. And Puck is given the instruction to hide.
I'll try and move Shapiro and Onus, I think, just under those, that canopy, try and move them to like there.
Sure, sure.
And get them covered.
You start to like move them in and like even just put a bit of foliage over them. And you know, one of them is kind of like, Shapiro might stir a little bit, like, you know, they are conscious. Well, they're alive. But they are pretty much dead to the world in terms of helping. But you start to cover them with foliage and stuff. What is everyone else doing?
I'm assisting with Puck, because my initial idea was to run over and hide behind the tree that they were at, to be a please don't fuck with my unconscious friends.
Sure.
So that's where I'll be.
And just so on that quickly, I'll get Swift Scale into that same kind of, as much covered in that area as possible with like the rocks and the trees and things.
Sure. So whereabouts are you putting them? Oh yeah, over there. Cool.
There's a lot of people tucked in that bush.
There's a few now. It's starting to get a little bit crowded there. What's everyone else doing?
I think I'm gonna kind of like walk over to Obak and grab him by the leash and try hush him. And I think I'm going to like tuck myself like in this little crevice here.
Yep. Yeah. Sure.
And then, as Obak's size is massive, kind of have him like cover my front in a way, and just let him graze and pretend to just be an animal in the bush.
Okay.
Which is it's you can't hide a ox.
This is true. Bang, bang! You see the tree starting to shake now. Hera, you instinctively think, oh, Puck's given the instruction to hide, and then you clock your size again.
Yeah, I look at all the small trees around me that are the same size as me, for like a hot second, see the people running to this canopy and go, oh yeah, good idea, and then go, so I will, it's sort of hard to tell, I guess, but is there any sense of direction where this banging is, where the footsteps coming from, or is it sort of just
you can get me
through the forest?
You can give me a perception check if you'd like. If you want to take a moment to stop and listen.
I am going to start heading over to this corner here anyways.
Sure.
But I will be trying to listen out to see if it sounds like I'm getting closer to it.
Yep.
That's a 15.
Run over and kind of back yourself into this wall, and as you do, you feel the wall as you get the northwestern direction of this thing is coming from.
Okay, cool. I'm going to then like crouch down and like
really get into
almost
it.
Almost like hanging up against the wall, like try and just be as flat and invisible as possible.
Sure.
These walls are here, sorry?
Yep, so they're about 10 feet each.
Gotcha, cool, thank you.
You know, it's obviously jagged and isn't the same all around, but yeah, you realize that you are in kind of a dip here. Ghost?
I will also just cast Guidance on myself.
Sure, how does that look?
Same, like running my finger up behind a certain nick in my ear where there are now all of these tiny little scars.
Yep.
And just that slight flash of red in the back of my eyes.
Can you give me a wisdom saving throw, please?
Eighteen.
As you cast Guidance, you feel the trees around you almost shift. But then you feel the guiding energy flow through you.
Okay.
It's getting closer.
Well, considering I was going to do this anyway, it's probably not a good idea now, but... I don't know that, and I'm imagining also what I do is in reaction to Puck's initial signal. I am diving off, probably seeing everyone diving off into the middle bush. We'll go for the one that the animals are near, I guess. And I sort of go to dive, like crouch down almost into it, and sort of scatter a bag of powder onto the ground as I do. And as I sort of crouch in there, I'm casting Druidcraft, and the plants almost start growing almost a little bit around me to just conceal me a bit more.
Nice. As you cast Druidcraft, can you give me a wisdom saving throw, please?
Saving throw? Not great at those, but I do get the cloak. Makes it a 12.
A 12. As the plants kind of start going around you, you feel like they are following your instructions. But then you feel like they stop for a second. And you feel a breeze. It doesn't feel natural. But they continue to cover in your control.
Cool.
And you get the sense of eyes. Yeah, we'll come to you in a second. Or not eyes, but a sense that something recognizes you. It's almost a sense that you have tried to run from. It's a sense that you thought was going to happen in the middle of a city street with a house representative recognizing you, but you just feel that recognition. It's a weird feeling.
Yeah, so Puck's done, tried to move everyone else, and he's, what he wants to do, is he wants to get a long way away from everyone.
Okay.
As far as he can out this way, using his grappling hook and running.
So,
and he's going to pull,
yep.
He's going to pull out the Horn of Silent Alarm.
Okay.
And my intention is, I want to try and lead this thing away.
Okay.
So I don't know how far I'll be able to get from the get-go, but I want to get out off to the west and start using the Horn of Silent Alarm on the creature.
Sure. So you want to start using it now, at, like, off map?
As soon as I come a little ways away from everyone, like off map, kind of far enough away from everyone.
Yep.
I'll be using the grappling hook to, like, you know, jump between trees and move as fast as I can to get away and start trying to draw this thing away. But before I leave, I'm going to throw a little bag of powder to Ghost, because you're closest to me. And I'll say, if worst comes to worst, get everyone around you and throw this on the ground.
You're lucky I trust you.
And he runs off.
Puck disappears into the jungle. Okay. Kira, you feel the stomps getting quite close. And you hear the breathing of a large creature. and it sounds like it's growling whilst also hissing at the same time. Boom, boom. Puck, you're letting off the horn now?
Yep.
Okay. You start to hear the direction from it as well, and you blow into the horn. Can everyone make me stealth checks? You have two automatic fails from Shapiro and Onus.
Does that include me?
That does include you, yes.
I have
20 for a 29.
I have disadvantage on this. That's a natural one.
That's fine. That just evens it out.
Yep.
Yeah. Two natural ones today.
Should have been a halfling.
as Puck's running, he's like, should have been a halfling. Should have been a halfling.
Well, we know what feat you'll be taking next.
Kira, you... Oh, you got an 11? Okay.
16.
Up in the northwest corner.
Oh, I can short rest, can't I?
You hear a giant lizard creature standing on two legs start to poke its head through the bushes. It sniffs. Fuck, you let go of the horn, and I think, Kira, you're probably the only one that would be able to see this thing if you kind of just poked your head up around the corner. Turns.
Yeah.
In Puck's direction. With a natural one on its perception check, it starts to rotate and slink off into the jungle towards you. Now, Puck, you start realizing that this thing is coming towards you.
That's no realization. That was the plan.
That was the plan. And as it does, you see it maybe 100 feet from you. It is giant in this jungle. It is kind of pushing trees to the side, but it also doesn't quite know what it's looking for. It has not detected you. It has just heard the sound.
Puck's used to seeing dinosaurs in a lot of ways, but uh-huh. Not ones this big or this dangerous up close. I'm going to keep heading out west and using the horn. Like, it's got four charges.
Sure.
So I'm going to be heading as far away as I can, and then and continuing to stealth.
With a 29, it cannot detect where you are. But it kind of slowly it's not charging or anything. It's just investigating the sound. But eventually you realize that you've changed its path enough that for it to turn around and go directly back would not make a lot of sense unless something major happened. So you could kind of blow the horn one last time and round it and then start heading back, and it will continue.
I'm not trying to send it back that way. I'm trying to send it west. I've gone out.
So you can blow it one last time, and if you get behind it and head back to the party, it's not going to do a 180 and turn around.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I didn't understand. Yeah, sure. I will try and do that.
I think it'd be one more stealth check.
That is an 11 for a modified 20.
Nice. You kind of get a little bit close to it, maybe 60 feet, just to get a look, and you see it's a T-Rex, like Swift Scale, but giant and muscly. The scales kind of go down its body and semi-turn into almost colored feathers, and it has a little horn on its head. Its teeth look like they could crush boulders. As it wanders off west into the jungle, not to eat tonight.
Definitely stay there for just a minute or so, just making sure it's not going to turn back, and it's not like you won't hear me when I try and leave again. But once I'm satisfied with that, I will probably initially quite stealthily, and then towards the end just move back quite quickly to get back to everyone and check, make sure everyone's okay. Probably coming across Hera first, everything okay? What's your area? Of course, oh no, okay.
Yeah. What's going on? Is it gone?
It's gone the other way, but we. Yeah, I don't think it'll come back anytime soon, but that was close.
Okay. Perhaps we make our move now. I don't want to stay in this jungle too much longer.
I think if we move around the jungle long enough, we'll come across something else like that pretty soon. Anyway, had a bit of a rest. Let's go see how everyone else is.
Okay.
Come over to Ghost. I'll put my hand out for the little pouch back.
I'm excited to see what that does eventually.
Yeah, another time. All right. I'll have a look at, just call everyone back over.
Yep.
It's gone. It's out to the west. They're not the smartest creatures, but I certainly don't want to fight one.
I'm sorry. What are you talking about? What's gone? You just told us to hide and that was that.
You would have heard it, but
yeah. Oh, we've heard of it? Okay.
But you probably just saw that, like, especially from where you were, you would have seen like the silhouette of it just leaving, or maybe the tail like going into the trees.
Yeah, gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. Hear that like guttural breathing or something.
Yeah. I'm going to say you've definitely encountered beasts before, Bargear. So.
Okay. Yeah, cool.
Not a comforting thought, but you know that Puck was probably serious about how this thing could have screwed you guys up.
Yeah, cool. Cool.
All right, so that leaves
can
us
I fully
with.
Stand up from where I was.
You go to do it, and the leaves move off you. Mm-hmm. No problem.
Good to know. Sort of warily walk back to the group.
Leaves us with two unconscious companions and a trek through a dangerous jungle in the middle of the night.
I don't like the idea of trying to travel through the night, but I don't think he's coming back. But we did make an awful lot of noise here with the crash. There'll definitely be things checking it out.
Vage, you said there was a river nearby?
Yeah, maybe we should start moving.
If we can just get to the river, at least we're somewhere. Set off strong in the morning.
Reese, can I recall which direction the river was?
Kind of to the east.
Kind of to the east. Yeah, cool. It's to the east.
And that could line up with Patrick's direction as well.
I'm gonna
carry these two.
I was just about to actually go do that. Yeah.
Should we put them on the rocks?
Yeah, grab Shapiro and Onus and gently rest them on Obak's back.
Okay.
And then I'll just walk. and then I'll walk alongside Obak, kind of holding him, but also making sure that they don't like fall off as we walk. And I guess I'll lead the party in the direction of the sound of water.
Sure. So can I get a marching order, please?
I'll stand either beside or behind Vargir and Obak.
Yep.
I'll go at the back then. Keeping an ear out.
Sure, on Swift Scale?
If he's not being used by the others, yes. By the unconscious people.
And then Ghost and Hero?
I think I'll flank the opposite side with Puck on Envy, because I have dark vision as well, so just keeping an eye on our left, our right and our behind us.
Sure.
And I suppose I'll probably just move into like the middle-ish, and I'll put my hand out on the back of Obak, so that I've sort of got a guide to follow, and I'm going to send Patrick out maybe like 60 feet in front of us and just sort of have him flop from tree to tree, just sort of...
Nice. The
looking out for big lizards.
Looking out for big lizards. Or anything else of danger. Give me a perception check on Patrick's behalf, please.
That's going to be a 21.
21, nice. As you start moving through the jungle, it is slow pace. Every footfall you put down, you kind of try and find your footing and then make sure you can step down. Next step, next step. Obek is strong, but two bodies on him plus some gear, like, he can do it, but he's not going anywhere fast. And with Puck and Ghost scouting in the back, you keep everyone in sight, but you kind of fall back a bit to make sure your tail is covered. Occasionally, Patrick does get the sense of movement in the jungle, in the trees. But by the time he looks there, there's nothing there. You kind of seem to get the sense that he gets a bit jittery of just trees waving against each other, a leaf falling, but then it catches on, you know, a piece of bark and gives a bit of a scraping sound. But you press on into the night. The closer you get to the said river, Vagi, you do start to hear the running water sounds. It means you're quite close. Ghost, he has gone, yeah. Being on the back with Envy, can we quickly describe how you've put her back together?
Oh yeah, that's a whole thing.
Or if not, so what she might not be here yet.
Yeah, I could have. I believe I can do it over a short rest.
Okay. It kind of slipped my mind. You have her pieces.
It also slipped my mind as well. Yeah, the fact that I have her body is really helpful.
Yep.
Wait, so
quick question. Have we had the short rest?
Yes. So you can...
So we can roll our things.
You can short rest, yeah.
Ooh, okay. Yeah, sure. It's gonna burn my last spell slot, but that's fine. Okay. Over the short rest, you see he kind of gathers the pieces together with this, like, slightly saddened and also very frustrated look on his face as he's working away at the fact that she was just cast asunder so easily. And starts just reconnecting, like, the main pivot points and that sort of thing with his smith tools and tinker's tools house, like, bending pieces back into rough shape until he can kind of get everything back together. And then he opens up a panel in the very center of the chest, right by where the kind of energy core is, and takes out one of his canisters that's almost double the size of one of his regular ones, pops a catch and slides it into the center of the core, and then with a click and a strong, like, sharp hum, the core kind of lights up, and all of the runes that bring this creation to a, you know, fully functioning mechanical servant light up all at once, and pieces start shifting and clicking, and almost self-repairing limbs spring out and start pulling pieces and tack welding stuff back together. And over the next minute, I believe, Envy's back to sitting up, moving shoulders and the hips and getting everything sort of clicked out. And it's back to being fully functional.
Nice. As you do construct her, can you give me a wisdom save, please?
Yeah. What is that? That's a 15.
A 15. 2 seconds. Okay. As you are constructing her, you know that your work is good. And you take pride in it sometimes, especially with things like envy. And you take pride that others can notice your work sometimes and see your craft. You kind of get a little bit of a rush when people are watching you work and things are working. You know, things are getting completed. You know, you're putting the right bolt into the right place and this compartment fits together with that. You're feeling a bit of success. But when you look up, you realize none of the party is watching you. That sense of watching just kind of washed over you.
Hmm.
But as you click the last bit into place, Envy realigns her shoulders and turns to you, looking at you like there has been no memory of fighting for you, but doesn't quite understand that she was not existing for a period of time.
Oh, ignorance is bliss, isn't it, girl? Just start patting mechanical construct.
Bang, bang, bang.
Ting, 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 ting.
But no, she snuggles back and will happily be the mount again as you and Puck follow behind the party.
At some point, as she's come back, and I suppose Molokov notices that she's moving around again at some point, I'll just wink to him and say, self-repair protocol. Knew it would come in handy.
That thing impresses me every day.
It's a little magic, I'll tell you what. Back in the forest, settling with Puck, however, kind of side settle up to him at one point, and you know, Shapiro had a pouch on him, kind of like my briefcase, extra dimensional space. Just right. Thought you should know.
Well, hopefully he wakes up soon. If he doesn't, then I think it's possible we might need to go looking, see if there's anything in there that can help us.
Let's hope he comes to and can go looking himself. So I wouldn't want to breach our very tentative trust at the moment.
No. No. It's a tricky position we're in. Yeah.
I can't shake this feeling that the forest is watching us.
No. I mean, this. I don't think I've had really a sense of this yet.
No.
There's there's lots of animals and things here. Is that what you mean?
I had this strange feeling while we were resting and I was putting her back together. It's just someone watching what I was doing, but it wasn't any of you. Just been haven't been able to shake it since.
I am concerned that we were attacked on our way in. But I suppose at this point, we don't really know if it was because it was us or if it was just pirates, really.
I can't say I know anything of Adaran pirates. Not Adaran, where are we?
Kobara.
Kobara.
Kobaran pirates.
No, but
I think
if it was about us, then how did they know we were coming?
As you reflect on that point as well, Ghost, in your research for Kobara, there is the democracy that the Dragonborn have, but remember they built New Throne as a fortress, and outside the fortress is tribes of lizard folk, there's dinosaurs, it kind of crosses your mind as well that there very possibly is outsiders, outlaws.
Yeah, it's generally a wild, untamed, unlawful place outside of the fortress of New Throne. mean, we've survived for now. That's a positive, right?
I mean, I'd like to keep doing that, but we'll see.
You and me both.
I think at the moment, the goal just has to be to get to the city and talk to the people we're here to help.
It somehow is still more comfortable than the mist. I'll give it that.
I can't help but feel at this point that we're getting a pretty raw deal from our so-called allies, throwing us into the deep end. And we haven't got a whole lot back from them yet. We'll see.
I'd hate to think it was intentional, but seems like we have continuously stumbled into the deep end of the pool. Yeah, we'll just keep floating, do what we do best.
Yes. Just something. If it was about us, if we were attacked because it's us, then this is not going to be an easy place for us to be.
Unless they already presume we're dead.
That's true.
Hera's not moving as fast in her giant form.
Yeah.
As you've kind of like caught up to her, and she's part of the conversation.
I mean, they're not going to find bodies, but they'll find the maybe T-Rex tracks and think, but I don't know. Once we show up in town, I don't think we'll be able to hide that very well. We'll see.
I have a sinking feeling they know we're already here.
You think
I just kind of assumed it. Say again?
You think that's what's watching you?
I don't know.
Puck just sort of idly grabbing the little amulet on his chest, going like, well, maybe this is what's keeping me from feeling that way.
I'd hope so. I mean, there isn't one of us in particular that's more of a target than another. I think it's pretty, at least might be well known to the Emerald Claw that we're something that's on their radar.
I would have thought if they were going to be trying to find anyone, it would be someone like Shapiro here. He's certainly a higher up, more visible person, but...
Is he kind of just flops on the back of Obag?
I wonder if he keeps his own protections.
Well, if he does, it would be nice of him to share that with the rest of us.
Hey,
Puck gets a visitor.
Almost at the river.
Yeah, as you say that, you can hear it maybe 200 feet in front of you, kind of thing.
How does that thing go in the water? I'll say about Envy.
Does a really good job at walking along the bottom. That's the benefit of not needing to breathe. We'll figure it out.
Molokov, can you give me a perception check, please? Natural one. As you guys come to a little bit of a clearing, should have been a halfling. Ahead of you, 50 or so feet, you see a river cutting through the jungle. It's not so wide at this point, 15, 20 feet across, but it does flow in a southward direction. As you kind of come out into this clearing, so it goes from north to south, yep. You come out into the clearing, you don't hear the sound of the trees moving around you, as it is masked by the river. Eventually, though, you get that sense of being watched again. And it feels like it's coming from all directions. That feeling you do get pretty strong, Molokov.
sort of... Fargeus, stop the beast.
Well, so I kind of grab her back. What's up? Yep, wet sucks. Sucks.
So we're like in like the middle of a clearing, and there's
The river's ahead of you.
I sort of unsling the shield from my back, and there's something here.
As I do that, I'll instantly kind of like take out my weapon, put my hand out for the people behind us just to stop.
Yep.
What do you mean? Where?
Everywhere. Something's watching us.
The rest of you would hear him saying this now.
Malakova, can I look around? As I look around, I'm just gonna look as he references everywhere.
You look around and you're trying to look into the trees, past them. Everything seems... you still get that sense that everything is around you is alive, but you can't see anything. Everything seems, you know, brown normal. And green and...
Malakova, are you feeling all right?
Ghost, you start getting the sense of being watched as well. You feel like that sense that someone's right behind your shoulder.
Check over my shoulder.
Trees.
You too, huh? I've been getting it since we left camp.
What are you all on about?
I'm gonna sort of have a did you end up taking the seeing glass out of... Actually, I don't even know that exists.
No, you don't.
No, cool. Never mind. Scratch that.
Look, Molotov, is
do you
it...
not know it? I think you know it exists.
Do I?
Wait.
I don't know.
No, you're the only one that...
Well, you don't know what it is. It, but I don't know what it does.
Yeah.
You don't know what it is, no. Yeah, you know what? At this point, you know what? I'll roll for it.
So to give you a visual representation of where you are, this is kind of what it looks like.
Oh, cool. Just happen to have.
Gotcha. I'm going to come, while Michael's doing that, I'm going to come up to Molokov and just kind of like gently like grab his shoulders. Is everything okay?
No, I don't think it is. Ever since we hid in that clearing, I felt like something could see us. Could see me.
Look, I've traveled a lot. Sometimes dense woods and stuff like this can feel very claustrophobic. It can get in your head a bit, and I understand, but I need you to keep calm. Keep you cool.
Give me a persuasion check, Vargir. Because sure. I think you're saying some truth here, is that these woods can play with your senses a bit, or especially deep jungle or sparse desert or, you know, arid frostlands and stuff like that. Like, it can kind of start playing with your mind.
It's a 15. 11 plus.
I was going for insight just to see, like, whether or not he believed him. I got a 5.
Yeah, You don't. Not only do you not believe him, but you get that feeling over your shoulder as well. And it's not the feel of being watched anymore. It's the feeling of, like, you almost reflectively move your shield there. It's the feeling of an attack incoming. And the hairs on the back of your neck start pricking up. Hera, you would notice this on Molokov.
Hera, can you talk to your friend here, please?
Oh, feels aggressive. I'm sick of this. And I'll trunce over to Obak and go through Onus's pocket where I know he always stashes seeing glass.
Sure. While you're doing that, Hera, you're going to respond.
Yeah, I'll just sort of slowly approaching Molokov. What's going on? Is everything all right? Do you want to keep moving?
I think at this point, like, everyone's trying to talk to him. He's just going, shush.
Yep.
Stop. And, like, he's... he obviously did that, like, instinctive move, but I don't think he's being particularly frantic. He's being... He's, like, ready for whatever's...
Yeah.
Like, you know, he's treating it as though there's something already there. He's not... You guys are telling him there's not something there, but there's something there. Mm-hmm. Simply ready for it. He can't see it, but he's not going to charge into the trees.
I think definitely as well, like, people are now talking to you from all directions. Like, even here, that's the most person you most trust, but, like, it's now a lot of people just talking to you. They're convincing you that there's not something there. I think that'd play in a little bit, but Hera, go ahead.
I was almost about to say, I'll probably, like, as I'm approaching him, sort of asking him what's going on. He's not being frantic, but I can sort of see where he's at, and I'll see that, and just to the rest of the group, just like, guys. And just try and get it to as silent as possible.
All right, everyone goes silent.
Just listening. If there's any movement or anything, we can only hear the river.
Only hear the river. Ghost, you finally reach into the pocket and pull out this lens. It's about this big. If you make a C with your fingers, that's how round it is. It comes with a little bit of, cloth. Yeah, massive. Us like finishing Diablo with the seeing eye lens, like.
I just had this in my robes.
Yeah. So it's about this big. It has like a little ribbon attached to it. So, you know, you can hold it without holding the glass, but you kind of pick it up out of his pocket as everyone kind of goes to a hush.
And I'll attempt to activate it.
Okay.
And hold it up and look at our party. Directly over Molokov's shoulder.
Sure, so which direction would you like to be looking at on the map?
Right now, initially, it's going to be a cone like this.
Yeah. So kind of looking southwest almost.
Like this direction, yeah.
As you do, you kind of put it up to your eye, and this doesn't necessarily have a trigger word. I think mechanically it has a couple of uses, but for now you put it up and you see the trees... Through this lens, I believe you've looked through it once before when you saw Tin surrounding Vargia, and you get that sense of green energy just on the kind of cusp of this prism. But as you look into the trees, you see through into the ethereal plane, into the true sight of things. And within the trees, you see a purplish glow. Almost of spikes and a carapace of an exoskeleton lingering in the trees, pincers on each of them, teeth protruding out as you see this creature here. And when you lock onto it and you're looking at it through the lens, you notice it shimmer and looks straight back at you before it screeches out. It starts scuffling towards you. So I think everyone can roll initiative.
You just hear from... Everyone's paying attention to Molokov, and you just hear from behind you, "What the fuck is that?" And then...
And then it peg squeals and writes a metal song. Oh, good.
What a waste.
That makes sense. I saw it first. 22.
Nice.
Natural 20.
Just gotta wait for Puck.
19. Good rolls, hello.
Okay.
Oh my god.
Yeah. as that thing scuttles out of the woods to you. Nice. Okay, ghost. No. Ghost?
Yeah,
Michael, 22.
22. Sorry.
Malakor?
13.
Hera?
With a natural 20, that's a 21.
Fuck, 19. And Vagia?
Put me at the bottom, Cap.
What'd you get?
8.
Not bad for initiative, to be honest. Let's move that out of the way. All right, as this thing starts scuttling out of the forest, it's, you see these tendrils on its back. They're almost like spikes that kind of like a rubber ruler. That's the kind of material it has. Yeah. As they kind of illuminate with purple, and it like opens up its maw as it runs towards you, and you hear also from the northwest and behind you screeches from the forest. So Ghost, you're up first. As you see this thing through this lens, and as you drop the lens, you see that it is now in plain sight.
Brilliant. That's so awesome. I love that, DM. I'm gonna pull out my gun and shoot it to draw everybody's attention.
Sure. Pull the gun. Reach out, go to attack.
That's decent. 21.
21? That'll hit.
Joss. That is 13 points of piercing damage.
Nice. You see the bullet rip through one of its scales, and it kind of screeches out and then just starts continuing on. And its eyes, if you can call them that, it doesn't even have eye sockets or anything, but you can tell this thing is focused in on you, Ghost.
Oh dear lord. I back up behind Envy.
Copy that. All right. That brings us to Hera.
Jesus.
I will say now that you can probably see the other two popping up. So there and there.
Where was the second there?
So top right and top left.
Oh no.
Yep.
Behind us. That's it.
And as far as you can tell, even especially because Ghost has moved back, Kara, you notice that these two are focused in on Ghost as well.
Yeah, sort of see the main one, hear the shot go off, sort of think about the noise, hear the other ones turning, looking. Oh shit. So I suppose I'm yes, maybe. What's the range? I'm gonna move myself to there, sort of like using that rock as a bit of coverage.
Yep.
So
Oh, I could do it like that. Yeah, because they're all going to be moving at the same sort of time. Yeah, I'm going to sort of rummage through my bag and pull out some scraps of paper. Because I had a cheeky little peek over the top at that large lizard we seen before. I'm going to start sort of envisaging that large lizard, and I'm going to hold an action so that when these two, presuming that they're going to be moving at the same sort of time, I'm going to hold an action until they're both within 60 feet of me, and then I'm going to cast Cause Fear at a second level on both of them.
Oh, okay. So remember that held action. Puck, you're up.
Yeah, so the one that was shot by Ghost, is the one down there?
Yes, that's correct.
Cool. All right, Puck is going to move down about there and just get a clear shot around the rock and fire off steady aim with his bonus action and fire off a shot with his enhanced crossbow.
Nice, go for it.
It's a 19 on the dice, so that's a 27 to hit.
That'll hit.
And so that's going to have my sneak attack. Yeah, that's right. Oh, that is good. That is 16 plus 6. So what's that? 22 points of piercing.
Nice. The bolt swings into it and it reels back from it.
Yeah. And then using the rest of Swift Scale's movement, I'm going to get on the other side of Vargia.
Nice. Kind of get out, take the shot, get back in.
Yep.
All right, that brings us to their turn. So what we're going to do is one was already running. So where can you go? It's going to move 80 feet here as it starts scuttling along the ground. But that is its dash as it kind of starts to round the party. The other two will move 5 feet and 5 feet. And do you want to let your spell off?
Yep. That should be enough. Yeah. And I can move a little bit closer.
Yep.
So I will sort of start whispering and crush the bit of paper in and almost envelop it over myself as form sort of starts to change, and even though I'm already quite big to those two, they will sort of see this giant lizard that we've seen before almost tear out of my skin and erupt around them. But obviously only they can see that. And it's going to be, I believe it is a wisdom saving throw from both of them, please.
Wisdom.
Yes.
Okay, so we have a 19 and an 18.
Fuck, they both pass.
As you envelop yourself in this and no one else sees it, but this spectral dinosaur starts erupting from Hera's form, what the rest of you do notice is that the purple spikes on these things whoosh, suddenly shoot up and glow purple as they move their gaze from Ghost to Hera and start coming straight in towards her.
Nine.
So that's going to be the rest of their movement into combat. As these things approach you, Hera, and these purple spikes are now glowing, and there is a hunger in them that they want to consume. But that is their action dash, so that is all they can do. Molokov, you see Hera get surrounded by two creatures. And you suddenly get that feeling of the gaze washes off you. I mean, they're here, but...
Yeah. They're not necessarily looking just at me anymore.
No.
Cool. I'm going to just look at the one coming at, charging at us from the south and nod at Varkir, hoping he can take care of it. And I'm going to charge up at this one that's just charged in at here. I'm almost trying to like, I almost run up as it's coming in and I'm trying to intercept it. Yep. I'm running shield first and I'm going to use my shield master feat. I'm going to try and give a bonus action shove.
Uh-huh.
So I need an athletics check from him against mine. I beat a natural 20 plus. It negates that natural one, not knowing where they are.
Oh, so close. So I got a 22 total.
I got a 26 total.
There you go. So where is he going? Shoving 10 feet?
No, I am knocking him prone.
Okay, cool.
And as he's on the ground, I just sort of pull the arm into a fist and slam down on him with a thunderous punch.
Nice.
Which I believe will be an advantage because he is prone.
That's correct.
Plus 16 to hit.
16 total will hit.
Yeah, I thank God for that. So D8.
Thunderous punch is also magic, DM.
It is magic.
Mm-hmm.
So that's 11 points of damage. Of thunder damage.
Nice. As it goes down, you see it kind of turn up at you, recovering from this punch. Is it a spell, though?
I am casting... what is it called? Booming Blade.
Booming Blade, yep. So it looks up at you and screeches in your direction, having seemed to lost all interest in here.
Cool. Doesn't like spells.
but that will bring us through to Varkir.
Yes, hello. So I'm going to run down and kind of... I want to get actually like right behind it. So I imagine that like Varkir's running through and like it's kind of stomping its feet down and he's dancing through them. And then I'm just going to give him a big old smack in the butt. which will be a not bad... 21?
21 will hit.
I will be smiting this. So that'll be an extra 2d8 on top of my 6. Cool. Yep. Great. That's not bad at all. That's 8. So 8 bludgeoning damage and 14 radiant. Is it fiend or undead?
It is not.
Cool.
So what was the total damage?
Total damage is 14 plus 8.
22?
Yeah, 22. Fucking my math is not working this morning.
Nice. 22. Big smite action comes in and seems to damage it quite a bit.
Cool. And then I'll just be behind it.
Cool.
With my shield up.
That brings us to the top of the round, Ghost.
Wonderful. Kind of gathering his senses now and seeing his allies jump to his rescue. He'll be like, right, kill it. And he's going to get Envy to run between Hera's legs if she can.
Large creature, so yes.
And end up on this side here. And Ghost himself will run around the back of Hera.
You're now flanking Hera if you want to attack her.
From behind Hera's leg, we'll poke around and take another shot at this one on the left.
Yep.
That's not as good. That's a 16 to hit.
A 16 will hit.
Oh, that's good. Come on. get a 10 on the D10 for once. That is 12 points of piercing damage.
And that's to this one here, isn't it?
Yes, correct. And Envy herself will take a bite at the one that Molokov's harrying.
Yep, and that's prone.
On the floor. That's that advantage. That's 20 to hit.
That'll hit.
That's one of these ones. Oh, that's not good. Ba-da-da-ba-da-da. That is plus two. 4 points of force damage.
Nice. Chomps down. Bites a leg off.
A whole leg? Nice.
A little bit of a leg.
And Ghost himself will back up. 1, 2, 5, 10, 15. This isn't difficult terrain or anything, is it?
No, it's not.
All right, wonderful. We'll back up to here.
Very nice. All right, that brings us to Hera. You're up. You're muted. Where's Anna when you need her?
okay. I feel like because I probably needed to concentrate on that spell, so I would have like almost had my eyes closed as I was casting it, and then would have sort of opened and been like, oh, fuck. And I suppose instinctively I'm just going to almost reach out as it's coming up and almost try and like pushing its maw away. And I'm going to try and like dig my claws in a little bit, and I'm going to cast Inflict Wounds on this one here.
Nice.
And trying to spread it around a little bit. And that's going to be a roll. Ugh. It's a 10 to hit.
Unfortunately, as you try and get this cast off, it kind of like flicks around and away from you, and you can't quite get a grasp on it, and the spell kind of just dissipates. But as the spell energy comes out, both of the ones next to you, Molokov, you realize the attention goes back to Hera.
Ooh. Okay. I want to take an opportunity attack. Oh, wee-wee.
At least one of them will be a disadvantage.
Yeah, I think I will just sort of, seeing that I can't quite get the spell off, and I suppose almost noticing that the spell's gained its intent, like its intent is still very much heavily on me. I think I will just move.
Okay, before you move, they will try and attack you. So we'll go for the one with disadvantage first.
Okay.
What are we adding on here?
Is that disadvantage because of your abilities, Molokov?
No, because he's prone.
Yeah, it's because he's on the ground.
I see.
So that's a 5. So that's a 12.
Ooh, a 12 will miss.
And a 24.
A 24 will not miss.
So that'll do.
I can. Wait. Defender poses disadvantage on attack roll of one creature can see within 5 feet. But the attack rolls against a creature other than the defender. Okay, yeah, I can impose disadvantage on that second strike with Envy.
Okay. That's still going to be an 18.
Yeah, 18 will definitely still do it.
15 points of slashing damage. And as you feel that slash, your foot kind of stumbles, and it is not going to let you move.
Yeah, all right. I won't move, then I'll just stay right here.
That brings us to Puck's turn.
Yes. I'm going to... Does the one that's been hit down here next to Vargi, does it look any worse for wear?
It looks pretty hurt. Bit hard to tell on these kind of alien creatures.
Hmm.
I mean, it's had a smite put into it, a gunshot and a bolt.
Yeah. And sorry, one of them is prone up here, is that right?
That's correct, yeah, this one.
How does prone work with ranged attacks? Is it you have
that your disadvantage? Will be disadvantage, yeah.
Disadvantage.
But I, oh, that gets cancelled out by my advantage.
And you have allies within 5 feet, so you still get your sneak attack if you hit.
Yeah. I just, it just cancels out the roll. Okay, I'm going to shoot the one that's not knocked over in the top left with a crossbow bolt.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to... Oh, I'm going to make my shot first. That's a 21 to hit.
That'll hit.
Cool. I'm going to do my sneak attack on that guy.
Yeah, go for it.
That is 21 points of piercing.
Oh, very nice.
I'm going to then use my Wails from the Grave, which means that the one on the right will immediately take 1d6 necrotic damage.
Nice.
5. And then with my bonus action, I will now shoot the one down next to Vargi. So that's just a regular shot.
Uh-huh.
That's a 19 to hit.
That'll hit.
For 11 points of piercing.
Yeah, it looks like it's just standing now.
Cool. Yeah, that's good. That's all three of them. That'll be the end of my turn.
All right. Let's go with Vargir. This thing turns around after being shot from all angles and smited from behind and will reach up to you and attempt to grapple you. So that'll be...
Contested strength.
Come
on, die. Oh, fuck you. Fuck this dice. It's a 7.
Okay, that was a 24. As it kind of wraps its pincers around you and you feel them kind of almost dig into your back, you don't feel damage, but you feel a surge of energy. And for you, Puck, as you let a shot off into this one, you notice this purplish energy start to like flitter around these spikes that are coming out the back of it, and all of a sudden you see them disappear and appear 60 feet away down this way as he teleports him and Vargir down here. Then he'll take his strike. It's going to be a 12.
That'll miss.
Unfortunately, up north, the same thing happens as one tries to rip it around Hera. So that's a contested strength check from you.
You have advantage because you're big?
They're both big, so I'm going to say they're straight. Oh, no, actually, yeah, you get advantage on your rolls, yeah. Because of your strength,
you get
yeah.
Advantage, yeah.
And it's just a check?
Strength check, yeah.
I'll take the first roll, which was 12.
A total of 12?
Well, I rolled a 12 and it's plus 0.
Interesting. Their total was 12 as well.
Ooh.
I'm not sure if that means they win or if it's...
Defender wins.
Defender wins. So as these claws go around you and you're stuck in spot, you just start flailing your arms around and you just manage to make it slip off you. But this one is going to stand up. And it is going to reach into Molokov.
So strength check?
Strength check. Oh, man.
16 plus 4, so 30, 20.
Yeah, this one stands up and you just bash its tendrils away. So they don't actually get to move away, but they will take their attacks. So one's coming at Hera.
As the wand lashes out at Hera, I will, that bright red strike flashes up Ghost's head again, and I'll cast Silvery Barbs.
Nice, so that's at disadvantage?
It's at disadvantage, and I have to roll one of these.
Oh, the natural 20 and a 2.
Yes. Although this is going to get interesting. Who's within 30 feet of me?
Thank fuck that was at disadvantage, because I think a natural 20 might take
you out. Yeah, you see one of these pincers just smash into the ground, and you stumble back and like goes just in front of one of your sandals and plummets into the ground, but the other one's going to try and attack Molokov.
Yeah.
Surely the rogue wants that advantage.
1, 2, 3, 4.
It's going to be a 7 on the die, so I don't think that hits you.
Nah.
1, 2, 3. As Ghost casts the spell, you see one of the spikes go haywire and turn like a darker, like foreboding crimson red, and actually shoots off and hits Envy for 3 points of force damage.
Oh. You just fixed her.
Yeah, it's not intentional, trust me. Ghost kind of like yelps out as the spell's cast. It almost looks like the spikes protrude out of his back and then fly off. It looks like it's painful.
All right. So Vargir, you've been bamped 60 feet. You kind of need to orientate yourself. But Molokov, you're up first, as you see these things trying to rip the party apart.
Yep, I sure do.
Hera, you can have advantage on your next roll within a minute. Part of Silver Rhubarbs.
Nice. I'm just going to say to Hera, don't let them take you. And I'm going to sort of... I don't want to move out of the one I'm in's range, but I sort of want to move up in between, like, I suppose I have to. So I am going to move like sort of up in between the two of them. Oh, not there. Oh, no. Sorry. Hair is big. This is hard to deal with. So I'm up sort of in between the two of them.
Yep.
And just knowing that they don't like magical abilities. In fact, he almost just turns back. He's almost keeping his back to the one there. And you can see the pipes and shit that protrude from the backpack. He almost lines it up behind and just pulls the chain. And I'm going to magic missiles all 3 darts hitting that one.
Yeah, sure. So I think that's straight damage.
That is just straight damage.
That is technically a spell, isn't it?
It is 100% technically a spell. Oh, fucking great darts. 10, 13, 14 points of force damage.
Ooh. Oh, my mic's still on.
14, can you make a dex save, please?
A dex save. Great at those. 9.
9. As the magic missiles, you pull the thing, you see the magical energy of them spark up into it. And as they do, you see the energy kind of pulse around its shell, and then it takes half damage and puts the rest of the half back to you.
Nice. Cool. Ouch. So, 7.
Yep.
Sort of not expecting that, and getting that backfire, takes the hit and pulls another crank. The sheen goes across, and I will give myself back my temporary hit points.
Nice.
And then just stand at the ready between, just tell Hera to get the fuck out of there. And
yep, as you do cast your temporary hit points, you see both of them focus in on you. But that brings us to Vargir.
That's my thing. Am I still grappled?
No, so you, once you've banked up here, the grapple kind of ends.
Okay, I'm not using this dice because it's a bad dice. Bad boy. Okay, I'm just gonna, I guess I'm just gonna roll a hit.
Sure, go for it.
More bad dice. Nine.
Nine does not hit.
Yeah, okay.
He's still a bit disorientated from...
Yeah, traveling. That's all I can do.
By teleport. Cool, that brings us top of round Ghost.
Oh, actually,
yep.
I just might come round behind it.
Sure. Ghost, you're up.
Yep. I'm going to, sort of taking a beat on what's happening behind me with Fargear, sort of look back and forth, but still think, hey. Here and Molokov are in the most precarious position, so I'm going to Mind Sliver on this left hand one. As I reach out, my eyes flash and that energy tries to. Yeah, Mind Sliver, it's a cantrip.
Cool.
Flash behind my eyes echoes in the creature's eyes. It needs to make a intelligence saving throw.
Ooh, that's a 4.
That is a failure, so it will take 6 points of psychic damage. And it has a 1d4 subtracted from the next saving throw it makes before the end of my next turn.
This is a spell, correct?
This is indeed a spell.
Can you make a dexterity saving throw, please?
Ooh. I'll take that natural 16 on the dice for a 2. Where's my saves? Nope. For a 18.
Nice. You see that the psychic energy goes into its shell and then finds a way to creep into its mind. It takes full damage from that.
Awesome. And Envy's just going to bite out again.
Nice. At the one on the...
At the one on the right.
Yep.
For a 18 to hit.
18 will hit. Go for damage.
Wonderful. Not great again. 5 points of force damage.
Very nice. Hera, that brings us to you.
Part of me wants to stay and fight. But majority of me wants to listen to Molokov and get the fuck out of there.
Just roll a dice for it.
Yeah. Negative, sir. That is probably going to be an action disengage. And I think I'm just going to run down here to the trees next to Obak. Do I leave Molokov in there? Holy! Because that's my action to get there, if that's the case. Diddly. Yeah, no, fuck, I can't stay in there. Otherwise I'm dead. I'm so dead. No, I'll just sort of action disengage and like sort of just like take an opportunity as they're both sort of swiping around to just slip out and back myself up to here. And I guess I'll just be like looking around sort of trying to assess what's going on where everyone else is, cause I've been up here caught in the midst the whole time, so just sort of like spotting Bargear, seeing how he's doing. But that's probably all I can do.
All right, Puck, as Hero joins the group in the center getting out of some of the fray, you are up.
Yeah. Seeing that, I'm definitely looking down to Vargir, who's suddenly very isolated and a bit worried about that. So I'm going to move over here. I'm going to shoot that guy down the bottom.
Yep.
Man, advantage is amazing. That's like a 24 to hit.
Amazing. That hits.
You
shoot and you shoot well.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not going to do sneak attack on this. That's 9 points of damage.
Nice.
Is it still up?
Still up.
All right, I'm going to shoot it again. And this time I will put sneak attack into it.
Uh-huh.
That's like a 24. What is that now? 23 to hit?
That'll hit.
And that is 12... 18 points of piercing.
That will take it down. Vargir, as you're flailing around with this thing, you see two crossbow bolts just whoosh, whoosh, over your shoulder and take this thing down. As it does, it falls down and kind of shimmers a little bit before just losing all of its energy, and just a hulk of a corpse is in front of Vargir.
Give him a little nod, and then I'll look up north, and I'm going to just position myself. Hera's looking pretty hurt, so I'm going to move myself in front of Hera with the rest of Swift Scale's movement.
Yep.
And that's my turn.
Nice. That brings us to them. They will each try and grapple Envy and Molokov. So we'll go for the grapple on Molokov first.
Oh, not good. What is it? Just a strength save or a check?
Check.
That's a 7.
As this thing wraps its pincers around you with a total of 11, you will bam.
Don't even need much.
40 feet in that direction. And a strength check with Envy.
9. Sorry, 10.
18 on the dice. So Envy and this guy will go 40 feet that way. Then they'll take their strikes. So against Molokov. Mm-hmm, that is a dirty 20.
I've seen these things deal out some damage. I think he pulls up the shield and it looks like he's about to strike past it, but the force goes a little bit beyond the shield's edges, and I'm going to cast shield and block it.
Nice. Bang! You feel the shield like almost shake to the point of force you haven't heard before, and it like reels back and it kind of like arcs itself up in front of you, ready to strike again. And then Envy is going to attack. Not as good. That is a total of 14.
Misses.
Bang! Smashes the ground in front of Envy as it kind of skits out of the way, trying to dodge these attacks. It's kind of like the... I can't remember what movie it's from, but you know, like the bang, 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 bang. The pincers are just hitting the ground and Envy's just trying to skit in between the two of them. But that does bring us to Molokov.
Alrighty. I was almost hoping this exact thing would happen. Get them away. Although that was when there was still three of them.
That I one think... will have a D4 off a saving throw, just so you're aware.
Unfortunately, I think shoving is not giving it a saving throw. But that's okay. Yeah, I'm just gonna sort of drop down low, and I'm just going to try and charge through its legs. I'm trying to knock this one prone now. So that's contested athletics.
Contested athletics.
Ah, I'm going to take it. It's a 13 plus 6. It's a 19.
That's a 19. 15 plus
4. Ah, so defender wins.
Yep.
That's okay. Sort of frustrated by that, I am just going to bring the arm back and give it a clock. I'm not going to do thunderous punch on it. I'm just going to do a normal punch. Another nat 20.
Nice.
Sick.
Do that damage.
Max dice. So 8 plus 4, so 12 plus 8. plus a d8. So 15 points of thunder damage total.
Nice. Boom. The echo of the thunder rings out across the forest. It looks pretty hurt.
Sick. But that's bonus action action.
Alright, Vargear. Doesn't appear to be here. Yo, you're up.
Yeah, sorry, family, just needed some stuff. Oh, shit. Okay.
So two crossbow bolts have flown over and killed this one in front of you?
Yeah. Yeah, cool. I am going to then dash straight towards Molokov. Running past... Thanks, Puck! But that's pretty much all I can do.
All right, Ghost.
Sorry for the wait.
All good.
Yep. Nope. Okay. Yep. Sure.
Everyone's measuring.
I'm gonna take my 30 feet of movement. And straight towards Envy. And I'll sort of double whistle. And Envy's gonna attempt to grapple the creature.
Okay.
Yep. So contested. Do you want strength or athletics? It doesn't really matter. Contested strength.
Doesn't matter for me.
Don't think it matters for me either. Natural 20.
Oh, well, there you go. It's a 15 on...
23, though.
Yeah, it's 15 total for me. So you grapple this creature.
Wonderful.
So you bite into one of its legs and like hold it in place and it tries to move.
We really did get all the ones out of the way. It's
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who needs perception when you fight well?
And I'll take a beat for a moment and almost half kneel down and take a shot at the pistol again.
Yep.
At the creature. Come on, do better. You'll never fucking guess.
That's
another nat 20.
Here we go, with the gun. Now you just need to roll a 10.
So does that mean I have two opportunities? So, first dice is automatically a 10.
Yeah, but that's not going to explode. That's just going to be 10 damage.
Understood. Come on. Ah, it's a 9.
9.
That's still pretty good, though. So that's 20... is it plus 3 or plus 4? Plus 4, so 23 points of piercing damage.
Nice, the bullet rips through the shell of this thing as Envy kind of holds it in place.
That's all I got.
All right, Hera, you're up.
Okay, well, I was not expecting them to be that far away from me. So I'll sort of get back there. Fucking see them bamf away. Molokov, fuck! And I will run over to here. And I'm just going to pull me wand out and I'm just going to cast Ray of Sickness at this one over here with Molokov.
Uh-huh.
Do I still have advantage on my next roll? Yes.
I believe you do, yeah.
I can hear Toast yelping in her sleep. And so 18 to hit.
That'll hit.
Come on. It's going to be 8 poison damage.
Nice. As you cast the spell, Molokov, you notice that the tendrils shift direction and it refocuses down onto Hera.
Yeah, that was more what I was hoping. So I'm also going to be keeping an eye on this one to see if I'm getting its attention as well.
Sure. Because you didn't direct the spell at it, it doesn't really focus on you. It's kind of focusing on Envy that's grappling its leg.
Okay, interesting. That's cool. But that is, I will probably use my last 5 foot of movement just to sort of...
Dip back?
Yeah, step back around that boulder.
Sure.
Nice boulder.
Alright, that brings us to Puck.
Hello. That's me. Puck's going to move up to here, so he's getting somewhat equidistant between the two of them.
Yep.
And he's going to shoot at the one that's taking off the, no offense, but the real person. And I'm going to try and do my sneak attack.
Yep, go for it.
That's a 22 to hit.
Nice, that hits. Go for damage.
That is 5, 9, 15 points of piercing.
Nice. As you line up your shot and it's refocusing from Molokov to Hera, you're coming around the side, you let off the shot and it just goes straight through its head and slumps down in front of Molokov, losing all of its energy and becoming a empty husk of a shell.
He's like already halfway through pointing the next shot at it. Turns, and you're going to shoot at the other one.
Nice, go for it.
Do I still get advantage on this roll?
It'll be advantage, but no sneak attack. Yep.
Yeah, I think that's how that works for rogues. Cool.
What do you... Advantage from what?
From having an ally within 5 feet of the target.
I don't think that gives you advantage. I think it just... It
just gives you sneak attack.
It means you don't need advantage to get sneak attack.
All right, cool. I will reroll because I rolled two dice, so I'll just roll one of them. That's a 15 on the dice plus 8.
That'll hit, so, yeah.
And then 11 points piercing.
Nice.
And then just to keep in check with them, I'm going to use the last bit of my movement to get to probably about there.
Nice. This one is going to definitely focus on Envy. It's just going to take two attacks towards it. Sorry, Envy. We have a 16 and a 19. Both will hit. So sorry, Envy. Plus four. It's going to be a total of 24 damage.
One.
Oh! As it starts just ripping into this metal thing in front of it. Envy is not looking so good. Those bolts weren't tightened just enough. And she's starting to fall apart again. That does, however, bring us to Molokov.
Yep, sure does. I think sort of at the ready, this one drops. Look around for where the other one is, see it off, absolutely turning Envy to scrap again. I will sort of unsling the javelin from the backpack, sort of give the shot a line up and throw it. It does have 120 feet as its long range.
So nice, but that will be at disadvantage. Yep.
Yep. Which is a 9 on the lower one, which is a 16 total.
Ooh, that'll hit.
Wonderful. It's just a d6, though. 10 points of piercing damage.
That's pretty solid.
As it sort of flies across the battlefield, launches into it, and then retracts back out.
Nice.
With this chain that's attached to it. Then I catch it again.
Nice. Very hurt, this thing is.
And I'll start making my way towards it again.
Nice. Varge, you're up. As you running towards Molokov, you see that one drop. As you kind of have to alter your course a little bit.
Yeah, great. Okay, cool. as I run past Molokov, Molokov will hear Varge just like... just sprinting across the battlefield.
Should have been a halfling.
Should have been a halfling. Molokov, are you hurt?
Nah, I've been hit once, but absorbed half of it with 10 hit points, got 10 points.
Meanwhile, Envy.
And Hera? Are you hurt as well?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, cool. Instead, then I will run straight up to Hera.
Yep.
And put my hands on Hera.
Excuse you.
you're doing well, big girl. And I'll give you 10 points of HP.
Nice.
And that will be... I'll just then... I had a little bit of movement left. I'll just come to the other side of Hera. And that's all.
Very nice. Go to top of the round. You're seeing something that's happened too often in 2 days.
Very much so. But strangely enough, almost automatically, that same pulse that you saw when Envy came back will go off. She's going to cast Repair on herself.
Nice.
So she's going to gain some hit points back. Not a lot of hit points, but that's still better than nothing. Gains back 8.
I think she'll survive the next round.
She'll survive the next, maybe. And I'm just going to take 5 foot forward and drop, properly drop to the knee, lining up the pistol and say, drop it. Oh, how's that cocked? You don't cock. One more time. I want to take a photo of that. That's another nat 20.
Here we go. Shoot that bullet. You're running out of bullets, I think.
Yeah, I have 2 left. It's going to leave me on 1.
All right, go for damage.
Let's go. If there's any time for a gun to explode, it's now. Oh, I was so close. That is 22 points of piercing damage.
All right, how do you want to do this?
As Envy kind of skirts and that pulse happens, you can see that the mechanisms start trying to fix themselves right before the creature like reaches up to lunge at her again. I just want to blow through both pincers and the bottom of the jaw.
Nice. As you do, it just explodes and before it drops and loses all of its magical essence. So, as you leave combat, these things, nothing but shells on the ground surrounding you. You almost hear the jungle come back to that normal just buzz. And you hear the river flowing, but it seems that the threat has disappeared for now.
I will look around in every direction through the eyeglass, just make sure we're clear.
Quickly looking around, give me a perception check with advantage.
16.
You look to the north, out to the west. You check across the river as well. Nothing seems to be hanging away from your party as you kind of look around. The trees start swaying again, the river's flowing. So outside the party, nothing seems to be of immediate danger. You kind of just take a breath and see that it is not seeing anything disguised or hidden.
Well, let's listen to each other when we say that there's something going on, hey?
To be fair, I wasn't expecting that.
I've never seen anything like those.
Envy's just gonna use both other charges of repair and
Heal
herself back up.
Sorry, I didn't believe in Molotov.
It's okay. It was staying well hidden. I don't know why, but I knew they were there.
Look, we probably made a bit of noise. Maybe there are things in these woods. Maybe we should just keep moving.
They seem to be tracking magic.
Yes, I think that's how they found us.
I was more talking about the big lizard that's wandering around. There's other things.
There are. You're quite right. Is it okay to move, or does anyone need a break?
I think
that's all right.
Let me just quickly have a look. I actually want to go over to one of the dead bodies, one of these things, and just sort of like inspect it and sort of have a look around on it. These sort of tendrils off the side of the head, just sort of working out how they imagining how they connect to the brain. And I'm gonna snap one off and take it with me.
Sure. Give me a... I think you can go Arcana check on these things.
That's only gonna be a 15.
A 15. So you see that these kind of spider-legged creatures, from looking at the sensors on these tendrils, they naturally sense magic and will glow purple when magic is used around them. You're not sure of the distance. From looking at its body, you can see that it can take one of two forms, like a cocooned, almost sentry form, which is when these tendrils will probably be on the lookout for magic, and then its spider form, where it hunts down and consumes magic users.
What a strange beast. Strange place.
As Hera's looking at that, I'm going to kind of lead Obak to the river. I want to see if there's like, I want to look in the water and just see if there's any, like, I guess in a sense, like pollution in the water, like is there rubbish that may have flowed down, like kind of giving way that there might be life or like,
sure, you know. Sure. Give me a nature check in that.
Sure. I am good at those. 14.
You kind of look down at the water, and you don't see any rubbish or debris flowing down, but you do notice that even with it being, it's not fast flowing, it's got a steady pace to it, it's quite deep at this point, even though it is narrow. You can tell that the river might expand at certain parts, but something does seem off about the water. You can't quite... You've traveled a lot of places. You've seen rivers coming from snowy mountains. You've seen rivers going through swamps. But something about this just doesn't quite line up with a river in the jungle. Is it the coloration of it? Is it the texture? You haven't touched it, but something just doesn't seem quite right about the water.
Sure. I'll kind of look back to the direction of the party. Hey, maybe someone might want to come have a look at this, but... maybe keep out of the water for a bit. It's just something off about it. I'm not quite sure what, but it doesn't seem normal.
Can I... I figure we've just cast a bunch of spells, so there can't be too much harm in casting one more. I am just going to walk up to like sort of the tree line where I am and... put my hand on one of the trees, and I will cast Druidcraft again as some of the vines just start going over the hand. And I'm just trying to, almost closing my eyes, trying to see if I'm getting that feeling of being watched again.
Sure. Give me a wisdom save. Or check. Wisdom check.
Natural 2.
From all the spells that were just cast and the sense of these things still just having just died, it's a bit hard to determine whether it was just these three or if there's more. But Ghost does relay back that he can't see anything looking out into the jungle. You probably haven't cast Identify on this item though, Ghost, so you probably don't know its distance that it sees up to.
Yeah, no, would have no idea. I'm just relying on the fact that Onus was using it.
Yes, correct.
And I know it does something.
Yeah.
But my ears will prick up at Vargir talking about the water, and he'll sort of wander over. And we are potentially dealing with a deadly infection. Or a virus.
That's true.
Perhaps it's in the water supply. Let me, I'll pull out an empty flask and just from the edge of the river take a sample of it.
Sure. You fill up the flask. No roll needed, but I'm assuming you're avoiding touching the water with your hands.
Yeah. You know what? I'll put on a leather glove.
Interesting.
From memory, I thought that we had heard that the virus was in the north.
That's correct.
Right? Or am I making that? Yeah, okay.
North of the city.
And is this river flowing south?
That's correct.
It's not a bad call.
So do we need to try and work out a way to cross it without touching it?
What?
Maybe we just stay on the side of it and walk up. Oh, sorry, here.
Yeah, I think if we just follow this river down, eventually we'll hit the city. Yes, the river will go down to the mouth of where Northrone is, I believe.
We haven't overshot Newthrone. We're south of Newthrone at the moment. I think we need to head north.
We were east of Newthrone. We were heading east. Yeah.
We're north of Hellcrest, aren't we?
Oh, fuck. Thing? We're lost.
That's the thing. Yeah, you're not sure where you are. But if I bring up the world map,
Newthrone's on the water, I think. I think here.
Yeah, is Newthrone? I think the question would be: is Newthrone a coastal city? Which feels like a thing maybe one of us might know.
I thought that Newthrone. Oh, Newthrone's at the bottom. Oh, sorry, I'm thinking of Whitecliff.
Yeah, because that Newthrone was just where we were meeting.
Yeah,
it's not actually where the.
They said the quarantine site was about 2-3 days travel north of the city.
Oh.
But we are going to. We want to go to Newthrone. So what Hera is saying is right. Of if we go south, if this is the same river, if we go south, then, you know, like who knows? Maybe this is just like a little tributary that leads into the river. Mm-hmm. We go south. We do hit the coast. We still have to cross the river at some point to get to the city.
Yeah. Hopefully there might be. Maybe they've already built a bridge.
I doubt they'd build one closer. Like the river's not going to get narrower between here and the coast necessarily.
No, but it'll get slightly more populated. Perhaps
you think there was much population outside of the cities?
No, I suppose. But
what's the gap that we're talking again for
at this current
about
point?
15-20 feet.
20 feet. 15, yeah. 20. Yeah.
Not quite enough.
We also have to get the mounts across.
Oh shit! And 2 unconscious people.
Yeah,
that's why.
There's no way to get, unless we could walk across. We're not getting across.
That's why I think we stay on this side, walk down. A bit of time.
Maybe we'll come across something. A fallen tree or
we
something.
We can't all use ghost spring boots.
No.
They're pretty helpful, but
hold up the crossbow.
Why don't we focus on finding somewhere relatively safe to settle down for the night? Tackle it again when we have some sunlight.
Do we want to head north or south then? I'm suspecting south to Newthrone, right?
Give me a survival check, Vargir.
Sure. That's a natural 20. 23.
Very nice.
Out of all my natural ones today.
Yeah. Not knowing or being able to identify what is wrong with the water, you probably could tell that heading north will get you to this site. Heading south will get you to the city.
Sure.
unless we want to go straight to the sick, then I think we go south to the city.
Thoughts, feelings?
Opinions.
And Ghost, are you still holding on to this lens for now? So you can add a Gem of True Seeing.
Well, how about we set we
do campaigns in a row? Don't dispel this one, please.
Don't use it and abuse it.
The our mission was to meet in Utah. I think it's where these two would like to go. As I point to the ones on the back.
That's fair. Onus never signed up for wandering through a jungle.
But I think, well, maybe we head south, get away from this site, and find somewhere as safe as we can.
All right.
If anything, should get up.
Say again, Dale.
Back to New Throne. I just said, if anything, Shapiro will have a contact in New Throne.
I also don't imagine he was planning on coming north of us. Or was that the plan?
No, I don't think he was.
Unsure. He did say that he was going to... He could identify the disease. He had equipment and stuff to... Okay, so I think the idea was he would go with you.
Yep, okay.
He probably intended to go conscious.
I would say so. North to the city, then. South.
Reese, as we start traveling, can I just ask, is there, like, a scent to this? You know how, like, some rivers have, like... Like, is there a scent to this water?
What are you specifically looking for?
Like, for example, like, if it's quite, like, a tropical or, like... heated climate, you know how sometimes it can, like, water can smell quite like mossy or green. Like, is that you've already told me that, like, the water seems unnatural, and this could just be a way of finding it, but, like, is there, like, some form of kind of, like, I guess rottenness to it, some Nurgle?
I'd say do another survival check.
Sure.
Or nature check.
Oh yeah, cool. That's a 14 plus 2, 16.
Bit hard to pick up a smell that's wrong with this river. It seems to fit all the normalness of a jungle river. But there's just something off about the water.
Sure.
Doesn't smell, though.
Okay.
At least not to your nose.
Sure. I'm going to make sure that I'm standing on the side of the river on Obak's side, so Obak doesn't just, like, attempt to start drinking it.
Sure.
Yeah, that's all.
Okay. Anyone else doing anything as you start to see the small cracks of light heading the sky, you know, approaching dawn?
Oh boy.
At least that makes it an easier watch.
What? Fresh during the day and travel at night? We may as well just keep pushing on.
I look at everyone looking pretty battered.
Well, the choice is yours. You can take another short rest, or you can try and settle down for most of the day.
It's less on the health. I'm worried about getting exhausted.
Yeah, to be fair, if we're walking through some pretty dangerous woods, I wouldn't mind having a little bit more utility under me than nothing.
We don't know how far it is to the city.
That's fair. Alright then.
Give these two a chance to wake up.
That's true.
Well, let's find somewhere sheltered then.
Alright.
As we walk down the edge of the river, is there a particular spot where maybe, I don't know, the river cuts into a rocky outcropping or something?
Not so much rocky outcropping, but the trees get a little bit dense at some points. You can find a spot to settle down.
any like caves or anything on the way? Like, I don't know, like.
Not so much. There isn't really big banks into the river. Yeah, not so much caves, or not in the short amount of time you would have traveled.
Yeah, sure. Okay. I think it's just best if we just find somewhere that looks slightly comfortable, some places to hide, just in case anything comes along, and hope for the best.
All right. So as you settle down, so is the plan a short rest or a long rest?
I think the plan was a long rest.
Start on the Arvo slash evening.
Yep, and everyone's on board with that. You start to see that the sky becomes a little bit lighter. And that's when you start to feel the humidity start to kick in. And it gets warmer and warmer and warmer and wetter and wetter and wetter. You feel the air start to get heavy, but just like a normal long rest, we're settling down. What's everyone doing?
I'll take first watch. Puck's not in a bad way at all. Yeah, I'll probably just try and scout out the area around us for a little bit.
Okay. Is anyone going on watch with Puck first of all?
I think I will.
Okay. Are you interacting with him, or are you doing your own watch? And then we can get perception checks after that.
I'll come up to Puck first. Any idea of how you want to do this?
I just want to have a look around, see if this is a regular tracks or anything that, you know, anything big passes through here. Make sure nothing's approaching us without being seen.
Yeah, just keep in mind that those woods can be pretty easy to get lost in, but don't go too far, maybe. Is there a way? Just don't go too far.
I'll be careful.
Oh, is that a little bit of concern there, Vargia?
Yeah, of course it is.
Alright, you can both give me a perception check then, please.
Bad dice.
Perception?
Yes, please.
19.
22. Nice. Mm. Being it is daytime, the canopy does cast quite a lot of shadow down here, but it is a lot easier taking watch during the day than it is during the night.
Yeah. Huh?
You hear the low hum of mosquitoes around the river, a couple of birds up in the trees, but for the most part, no large creatures have left tracks around here, and it doesn't look like this is, there's no path or anything, so it doesn't look like this is frequently traveled. The end of your watch comes around, as the heat is pretty immense at the moment, intense, as you're approaching kind of midday-ish.
Yeah, this will be the first time Varga has probably ever taken off his massive cloak. And you'll just see like big green furry chest.
Yep.
As he kind of like is like sweating.
Yep.
And he'll just pop it down and wrap it up as a little pillow.
All right. And who would you like to take? Oh, you're gone.
When he does that, I'm gonna take a look at his arm.
I think it's still bandaged.
It is still bandaged.
Has it moved beyond the bandage?
Give me an investigation check.
Nineteen.
It has not moved above the bandage, and I think by now Vargia would have rewrapped it so it isn't that loose that you saw through on the ship.
Cool.
And who is taking second watch?
As I kind of like come down, going down to bed, I'll bop Ghost on the butt. You're up.
Oh, jeez, when it gets so warm.
Yeah, it is uncomfortable, Ghost. Now, you've been in hot climates, but humid is another monster.
Yep. Strips off his, like, the sort of heavy double-stitched dwarven sort of work coat lays that down. Just like just in this bandolier and like silken shirt, which is probably drenched at this point. Oh boy. And I think we'll first thing he'll do is he'll take his 50 feet of rope and string it at sort of his chest height, so like 2 feet off the ground, and a lattice around sort of the trees on the outskirts of where our camp is, and then right at the end closest to his actual companions, he'll put a, what do I have? Doesn't really matter, does it? Just an anything. Oh, I have a pitten. So I'll put a pitten in it. Nice. And take out my smith's tools and like flick through a couple of eye presses and press a couple of small runes into the base of it to record a message. And it's I have to say it out loud first, so I'll say danger incoming about 4 times. So this is just a magical tinkering.
Sure.
With the trigger that when the rope pulls on the pitten, it'll relay the message.
I like it.
And then I'm going to sit sort of at the base of camp so I can still have an eye on the general surroundings. But I am going to sit with the gem is seeing for about an hour. Just getting a feel for it, attuning to an item.
Sure. So you attune to it, and then no problem, and you get all its properties, and we'll count this as a full. As full, since you've just attuned to it, so it is the full item.
Oh sure, yeah.
After about an hour, you see that this lens, not only does it kind of enhance and magnify in a bit, but it sees things for their true selves. It sees just beyond the plane of existence you're on, and we'll discover things. You kind of are clicking bits together now. You saw it on the ship, which kind of indicates that there must be something going on with Bargear. You saw the beast hiding in the jungle, and you also see that this is what Onus is probably using it for, to see different aspects of how to travel the ship.
Everyone's waving.
Hi, Nigga.
But yeah, now you fully understand it. You can see the use of it. But also that kind of does trip you up, that he saw something on you and you saw something on Vargir. He probably did check all the party as soon as they got on board.
Yeah. And for the sake of...
Also, I will say as well, when it's a use, it isn't like a one-time look at something. Like, you use it, and however long you're using it for, that's fine. But as soon as you, like, take it away, that's a use gone.
Oh, okay, so it's not for 10 minutes I can continue to use it.
Correct.
On one charge. It's like, you use it, and you look, and yep. Then that yep. charge is done. Okay, cool. So for the sake of it, I will, now that I've attuned to it,
yep.
Activate it, and actually take a good look at the party, as well as Onus and Shapira.
Okay. As you fiddle around with it a bit and look out and turn back to the party, I guess I'll pass it over to any of you four. Does he see anything with true sight that will be revealed? I guess we'll start with Vargir as you are gone back to sleep. Just describe what Tin would be doing around you.
Yeah, I think you've seen Tin before. She takes a form of like quite a young looking elf, but kind of spectral and ethereal. And she's just kind of sitting by my head, by my back, and kind of just like stroking my head. What looks like kind of just like as it strokes across, like you can see it kind of just like ghost, like a ghostly form, the fingers kind of disappear and then reform, but it looks like she's just trying to be gentle.
Nice. So just a reminder to everyone else, true sight. Invisible creatures or objects automatically detect visual illusions and succeed on saving throws against them, and can see into the ethereal plane as well. So anything kind of just gets revealed around a person if they're concealing something or trying to. I think your mark would show up, Molokov. You see a mark on Molokov's shoulder and how it blends into his metal arm. You've seen his metal arm before. I guess around Hera, you see a little bit of almost just dark energy, just little specks of it. Nothing major though. Just her necrotic presence. And I'd say you do see that kind of similar kind of hue to Puck's mask. It doesn't give off any magical indication, but just almost like a trace of something.
Hmm.
Then you change your focus to Shapiro and Onus. As you have taken their item when they're unconscious. As their bodies are laid, I would imagine they're off the back of Obak at the moment. You kind of laid them on the ground.
You'll set them up nicely, like yeah. Lying down on a bedroll or something, yeah.
And as you do, you see that they are not shallow breathing, but almost something is giving the illusion of a breath up and down. And as the gem goes over them and focuses, you kind of turn it a little bit, you see that their skin is not an illusion which you checked when you were checking the body, but almost a suit. As the metal bones beneath of two warforged lie unconscious and heavily damaged against the trees.
Oh shit.
Explaining not eating and not sleeping and the heaviness of their strides, you see before you two warforged disguised as elves.
Wow. That would also explain the regular healing not fully working on them. Because just kind of sits there for a minute. Like, does a double take, turns the lens again, and it kind of flicks back to their elven forms and turns it, goes back to their warforge. Huh. What? Well, heavily damaged. Oh boy. Okay. All right. We'll put the gem down. Sort of think to himself. Like, I think a weight comes off Ghost's shoulders. That, like, slight bit of mistrust that had been sitting there of not knowing just gets a little bit lighter. And for now, he'll just continue the rest of his watch.
And I think that is where we'll end the session. Going into the late afternoon. Uncovering truths.
Houses.